Thomas Jefferson spent 5 years in France as our nation's minister to France in the 5 years before the French Revolution in 1789. And he came back and served for 5 years as Secretary of State under President George Washington. And so that's 10 years essentially he served in the diplomatic corps of the United States. And he was always thinking about proper relations between nations and Indian tribes, between societies, and how to expand his vision of freedom and the rights of man and self-government, equality, as I mentioned, and the pursuit of happiness. So when he came back from his service in Europe and during his service as the Secretary of State, he kept looking at the opportunities that the westward expanse of the United States presented in order to establish this continental empire for liberty, as he called it. Some of his readings in the 1790s, as he served as Secretary of State and later as Vice President, were of the Canadian explorer Alexander Mackenzie, who had taken an expedition from British Canada out west across the Canadian Rockies to Vancouver and staked the claim for Canada and for Britain across the country to the west. And it was quite clear in his mind that unless America engaged in similar affirmative outreaches across the region, that other nations from Europe would establish their dominance and perhaps even new and separate nations out west. This was something that was a great concern for Jefferson because he obviously wanted to establish representative self-government through our democratic institutions as reflected in the United States Constitution over a large expanse of territory from which it could not be threatened in the new bold experiment that was the United States of America. Americans today tend to assume that the existence of their country in the lower 48 states across the entire continental expanse was an inevitable result. It was going to happen, nothing could stop it, and it really didn't have to be led, nurtured, envisioned, fostered by any leadership, and that it couldn't have gone any other way. My own view is that this is quite a distortion of the truth, and that it was quite indeed possible that if you'd had different leadership in the United States in that early one quarter of the 19th century, the quarter that was led by Jefferson and his friends James Madison and James Monroe, you might have had a very different result. It's quite possible, at least to my way of thinking, that had the Federalists won the election, the parochially minded, New England focused Federalists, had they won the election of 1800, we could well have had 5, 6, or 7 different nations occupying the territory that is now occupied by one nation, the United States of America. Thomas Jefferson faced bitter opposition as he sought the presidency in the late 1790s. The opposition came from the Federalist Party, which was the party of Alexander Hamilton, John Adams, and George Washington. And that party tended to favor the interest of the elite. They also tended to be a parochial party. Their centers of power were largely in New York and the New England states. And they were concerned that any expansion of America westward on the terms that had been established in the Northwest Ordinance would tend state by state to dilute their power and their influence. Thomas Jefferson fought the Federalists bitterly across a whole arena of issues and beat back their attempt to repress his viewpoint, his vision, through the Sedition Act. He sponsored and led the fight against the Sedition Act, which made it a crime to merely utter your opinion in criticism of the central administration. Thomas Jefferson's vision of light and liberty triumphed in the election of 1800. And it put Thomas Jefferson in a position to really do something about the creation of America as a continental empire for liberty, to give America a physical reality within which to express the inner vision which he was articulating throughout his life, the vision of light and liberty, of freedom and oneness. Early in his administration, Thomas Jefferson was presented with an opportunity to acquire the Louisiana Territory by purchase rather than by conquest or haphazard settlement. This occurred because of the eternal wars of vanity and imperialism that Napoleon had been conducting. Napoleon needed money to conduct those wars against Britain and the other countries of Europe. Napoleon offered to sell New Orleans to the United States. As soon as Thomas Jefferson heard this, he authorized his representatives in Paris, particularly James Monroe, to pursue the offer and to expand it if at all possible. And as a result of some intense and rapid diplomatic negotiations, Thomas Jefferson agreed to purchase the entire middle third of the United States from Napoleon for the sum of $15 million, a very large sum at the time, hoping that later Congress would ratify his agreement to purchase this new territory. Congress did approve that purchase. So this Louisiana Territory was the territory to the west of the Mississippi, up the Missouri River, all the way up to Montana, and out into Arkansas, about one-third of the territory of the current United States. Territory comprising 15 current states of the United States. Now, Thomas Jefferson didn't stop there. As soon as he effectuated the purchase, he commissioned an expedition to explore the new territory. This expedition was, of course, the famous Lewis and Clark Voyage of Discovery, as it was called.
My message to Congress proposed the sending of an exploring party to trace the Missouri to its source, to cross the highlands, and follow the best water communication, which offered itself from thence to the Pacific Ocean. Congress approved the proposition and voted a sum of money for carrying it into execution.
The two individuals that Thomas Jefferson selected to lead the expedition out west were quite extraordinary individuals, particularly Meriwether Lewis.
Captain Lewis, who had then been with me near 2 years as private secretary, immediately renewed his solicitations to have the direction of the party. I now had opportunities of knowing him intimately, of courage undaunted, possessing a firmness and perseverance of purpose which nothing but impossibilities could divert from its direction, careful as a father of those committed to his charge, yet steady in the maintenance of order and discipline, intimate with the Indian character, customs, and principles. Honest, disinterested, liberal, of sound understanding, and a fidelity to truth so scrupulous that whatever he should report would be as certain as if seen by ourselves. With all these qualifications, as if selected and implanted by nature in one body for this express purpose, I could have no hesitation in confiding the enterprise to him.
Lewis and Clark were both captains in the United States military. They were well-trained and well-schooled to the outdoor life. And they pulled together a team of perhaps 20 other military soldiers from the United States Army, took the money that Congress appropriated, outfitted themselves for the westward expedition, and set off in the year 1804. It took them 2 years. They returned in 1806. Now, this journey was a journey of scientific discovery in significant part. Thomas Jefferson was always interested in the American Indian tribes, the positive things that they had to offer, how we could establish peaceful relationships with them. He was interested in botany, agriculture, horticulture, archaeology. The whole range of natural sciences were of great interest to Thomas Jefferson. Thomas Jefferson measured the temperature twice a day during his entire life, and he studied climate patterns intimately. He wanted Lewis and Clark to really treat this seriously as a scientific expedition, and they kept massive logs. In fact, most of what you see in their logs is notations and observations about the natural conditions, the conditions of nature and all of its manifestation and glory as they encountered it on their journey west. Many of the things that they saw had never been seen by the white man before.